Welcome to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Michael W. Dean of the Freedom Feens cooks up a very special blend of liberty, guns, sex, rock and roll, drugs, and thriving in spite of the state in an increasingly worrying world. All with a rotating cast of nifty guests who are also up in the middle of the night.
Welcome to another episode of the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Our guest today is Jodie Emery, marijuana activist, all-around good person, and wife of political prisoner Marc Emery. How are you doing today?
I'm doing very well. It's a very busy time here. We have lots underway and 420 is coming up, so that's a big time of year for the cannabis culture.
On my end, 420 the time is coming up in a few minutes.
Yes, 420 the date, April 20th, which is a day of celebration and protest, a celebration for the cannabis culture and protest against prohibition.
Talk a little bit about who you are and what you do and who your husband is and what he's done and what his situation is, please.
Well, Marc is a longtime activist for many different freedom causes, starting in Ontario, Canada. He's Canadian. He used to fight against obscenity laws and any sort of laws that basically harmed people who harmed no one else. And he discovered that books and magazines about marijuana were illegal in Canada. So he imported High Times magazine and Jack Herrera's book, The Emperor Wears No Clothes, to try and get the police to arrest him so he could be charged and change that law, which was a form of civil disobedience he had used many times before and even to success in fighting other laws. So he brought these books and magazines into Canada, discovered cannabis was amazing and prohibition was awful, and started advocating against that. He moved to Vancouver in 1994, where he opened up a store called Hemp BC, which sold paraphernalia and marijuana seeds, which nobody else was doing, as paraphernalia sales had been cracked down by the government for many years prior. So Marc started doing this to try and bring life back to it and helped open other stores across the country. And he sold marijuana seeds, promising to use the money from those sales to advocate against prohibition, to fund rallies, protests, conference, any legal challenges, compassion clubs, organizations around the world, political parties. He started the BC Marijuana Party, which ran a full slate of candidates in 2001. And he used the marijuana seed money, which was millions of dollars, to help back medical marijuana ballot initiatives in places like Colorado and Washington, D.C. And so his money went all over the world throughout the United States and Canada, millions of dollars to different lobbyist groups and court challenges and all sorts of individuals and organizations. And in 2005, the United States government had him indicted along with two others to face life in prison for conspiracy charges related to those seed sales. However, if you go to the front page of our website, www.freemark.ca, and that's Mark with a C, you'll see the DEA's own press release on the front page, which describes that Mark was arrested for his political activities and legalization advocacy, and it didn't even mention seeds once. You'll also find a lot of other information about Marc and who he is and what he did on that website and by simply Googling his name. I moved to Vancouver in 2004, and I had known about Marc before then and got involved with rallies and protests and writing letters to newspapers here in Vancouver and spending time at Marc's store, which is the BC Marijuana Party bookstore at the time, where seed sales took place in the back, and Cannabis Culture magazine, which he made for many years and produced and was sold worldwide, was produced here. We also have Pot TV, which was one of the first websites on the internet to stream live video long before any other websites came around back in 2001. Pot TV was well recognized for being well ahead of the curve in terms of video broadcasting, and that archived a lot of activity in the marijuana movement and just the fight for freedom against the U.S. government and other oppressive governments. And so that archive is kind of old, and we're updating it as of now, actually. We're going to be relaunching Pot TV. But Cannabis Culture, Pot TV, the BC Marijuana Party, and the bookstore here, and Vapor Lounge, which we opened after the DEA arrested him, plus the Marc Emery Direct Seeds, and Marc's endless running for office, for mayor, for different levels of office, for getting a lot of media attention, going across the country, smoking out police stations to prove that marijuana laws were no longer in force and effect of the summer of 2003, which was true, and the charges were dropped. But Marc did a lot of great big publicity stunts and was very vocal and active and recognized for bringing attention to marijuana and to the fight for legalization. And again, in 2005, when the DEA had him arrested, he was facing life in prison, possibly for his activities, when he never left Canada and he always paid taxes on his seed sales. He always paid income tax, was well known, well in reach, always very transparent and open and accessible. His phone number was online. Everybody knew who he was, what he was doing, why he was doing it, but the U.S. government wanted to stop him because he was very successful sending millions of seeds to patients in need all throughout the United States, and especially California, where millions of seeds were sent for great variety, which has led to a massive medical marijuana market that exists there and other states today. So Marc was responsible for a lot of progress made in the United States, in Canada, and around the world, and that's why he was targeted. And he was fighting extradition for 5 years. I married him in 2006, the year after he was arrested, and have been alongside him ever since 2004 when I came to Vancouver. One of his co-accused, Michelle Rainey, his business partner, passed away from cancer in 2010. But thankfully, she and the other co-accused, Greg Williams, didn't get any prison time because Marc agreed to take the bulk of it, which is the point of going after somebody and getting co-accused to make them plea. So Marc was extradited in 2010 in May by the Canadian Conservative government we have in place here, which is very evil and corrupt in every way, just like the American government. So Marc was extradited and sentenced to 5 years as his plea deal in Seattle in 2010. So he's been in the United States experiencing both the private prison system, which is a for-profit private prison system, very shoddily run, very bad. He blogged about that a lot, getting the attention of the government and the Bureau of Prisons and Geo Group, the prison company, which moved him to a federal facility in Mississippi where he is today. So if anyone wants to read Marc's prison blogs or find out more about that, it's very easy to find at freemark.ca and our main website, cannabisculture.com. Myself, I've just been an activist in terms of running for office. I ran with the BC Marijuana Party in 2005-2008 by-election and was asked by the BC Green Party to run for them in the 2009 general election, our provincial election, which is like a state election. So I was running then as the third party candidate, and that went very well in terms of bringing attention to the issue, and that can all be found by looking up Jodie Emery, BC Green Party, or Jodie Emery for MLA.ca or .com. And you can see that I've been doing extensive interviews with the media for many years. I write a lot of letters to the newspaper. I'm invited to speak at different events, both pot-related or politically related. I testified at the Washington State Legislature in favor of legalization last year alongside my husband's former prosecutor, John McKay, who is now in favor of legalization. And I help organize rallies against the Harper government that we have here in Canada. I try to advocate and educate as much as I can. And if anybody wants to see more about who I am and what I've done, Google can help you out with that.
I really appreciate what you guys do. I don't personally smoke marijuana, but my only child died of leukemia and broke the law to smoke to get some relief. And the thought that someone could have put her in a cage for that just drove me into doing what I'm doing. You guys do good work. How can people help Marc or help you?
Well, the best thing people should do is educate others and take a stand wherever you are, no matter whoever you are. There's ways that you can make a difference. Even if it's anonymously calling into a radio station when they're talking about crime and giving a name that isn't even yours because you have kids and a job maybe that you can't lose. But if, you know, even if you feel you can't be publicly in support, you can find ways to back others who are trying to be activists in their own right as well. Marc wrote a really great article called Advice for Aspiring Activists, and that can be found on freemark.ca and on cannabisculture.com. And it's a really great article just explaining what it is required to become an activist. You know, he has a lot of other articles, too, that we have on cannabisculture.com. If you check the activism section, we have how-to articles about how to hold a rally, how to hold a protest, how to open a head shop, how to open a dispensary, all sorts of different ways to get inspired to make a difference, because there's endless ways, but most importantly is to do something you enjoy. So if you feel you're good at writing, then write letters to newspapers. If you feel you're good at speaking, perhaps organize a coffee house chat somewhere to educate people about cannabis if they're interested. So there's different ways, and you know, finding articles online through our website is a way you can get involved. As far as Mark and I go, we just appreciate any words of support that we get. People can send him mail if they like. His mailing address is on the front page of freemark.ca. Sometimes we get cards with contributions towards my visits with Mark, since he's so far away and it's quite a trip to go see him, but it's so important for us both to get through this. Some people choose to contribute, and we're grateful for that. We don't really like to ask anything of anybody, because we do get so much kindness and support just in return for what we've done, that all we really want to do is continue to inspire others and take whatever positivity we receive and somehow put it back out there for everybody else. Because even though it is true that we're going through something very challenging, it is very difficult being apart, and you know, we still have more than 2 years to go, and we've only just finished up two pretty soon here, so it's an ordeal. But there are people who suffer far worse than we do, who don't have the support system and the fan base that Mark does have. So I mean, even people like yourself, to lose your child like that, I just can't imagine. And it just breaks my heart that there's so much suffering out there, not only just from lack of access to medical marijuana and the potential that it has, but also because of how many lives are lost due to the war on drugs and the incarceration and military aspects of it. So it's a great civil rights violation going on. It's a great human rights crisis that so many peaceful, nonviolent people continue to be persecuted. And Mark and I try to bring attention to that and remind people that we're not just talking about him being in prison and him not, you know, not supposed to be there. It's so many people all around the world that we hope to represent as well.
Cool. Hang on. I'm going to save this file. We're having 60-mile-hour winds here in Wyoming, and the power tends to go out when that happens.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com. Did you marry Mark while he was in prison, or did you know him before? I knew him before.
He wasn't sent to prison until 2010, and I moved to Vancouver in 2004, so we had quite a few years together. There's a lot of videos of us at events and speaking together at marches, and yeah, so we knew each other very intimately, very well, in many years leading up to it.
My wife and I were very touched by your videos, and that you carry on his work while he's in there. She's on board with everything I do, and we were very touched by it, especially the Christmas ones. They're kind of heartbreaking and beautiful and uplifting.
Okay.
If this isn't too crass of a question, I'm sure it's something people would wonder. Are there conjugal visits in federal prison?
It's a popular question. Not too popular, but people want to know. And the answer is no, not in federal prison, only in state prison. And quite frankly, I'm not sure it would be quite the environment I could get comfortable in. It would be nice to have better visiting, to be able to just move around, because we have to sit together for so long without going outside or anything, just in this big room with lots of other people. So it'd be nice if we had other options for visiting, but we still appreciate every minute that we do get together, though.
I know it's no country club, pardon the term, or picnic for him in there, but he does have a rock band in there, doesn't he?
Yeah, there's a music program in most federal facilities, so they provide guitars and instruments for the inmates. So Mark started learning bass guitar. He's never done music before in his life, but started learning how to play guitar and then the bass, and had been in a couple different bands, a reggae band, classic rock band, oldies band, and formed his own called Yazoo because he's in Yazoo City, Mississippi, and the prison is the medium security facility at Yazoo Correctional Complex. So he formed his band, and that's been wonderful for him to be able to focus on and have something to work on, and takes up a lot of time and is entertaining. So I'm happy that he has that, and people can read about it in his blogs too.
Does he have internet access there, or does he send you letters and then you type them into the blog? How's that work?
There's no internet access. There is, however, a computer terminal with a program called Corelinks on it. And Corelinks is a limited monitored email type system that the Federal Prison Bureau of Prisons has set up. So inmates can have up to 30 different contacts. That requires that I would give my name, my mailing address, my email address, and my phone number. So everybody who wants to be in contact with an inmate needs to provide all that and then is added to it. Emails take about an hour to 2 hours to get between being written and sent and received at the other end, and they're all screened for anything that might raise alarm, I suppose. So it can take some time for that. And each email costs money. I think it's like 30 cents in a minute or 5 cents a minute. Some sort of gets expensive for sending messages to people on there. So that's how he communicates with me and a few other people, and we can send him news stories and stuff. You can't send attachments or anything. It's just basic text, drop-down menu of his name or other inmates. But I just choose his name, type something out, and send it. And that's the contact that we have. So it's not internet. He doesn't get to see websites. He doesn't get anything like that.
Where are you from? Where did you grow up? And what was your journey to liberty?
I'm born in Kamloops, BC, British Columbia here. And I was born and raised there. I used to be anti-drug, kind of teacher's pet. I was kind of an artist, gothic, intellectual type person in high school. But I got along with everybody. And my next door neighbor, who was a good friend, and another friend started smoking pot, and I was always chastising them for it, as I did for everybody who drank booze or did anything that teenagers typically do. So I was a bit of a little authoritarian, really, in high school. But they introduced me to Cannabis Culture Magazine and Pot TV and everything that Marc had done. And 2001 was the year of the election that the BC Marijuana Party ran a full slate of candidates in, which was a record-making achievement. So I went to a rally in Kamloops in my hometown when the bus came through. The Richard Nixon's old election bus was used for the BC Marijuana Party election campaign, actually. You can find photos and info about that. So that bus was turned into the Cannabus and came rolling through Kamloops. And around that time, I started using cannabis with my friends and realizing that it wasn't a problem. So, yeah, that's how I got introduced into the culture in that sense and started changing my mind in terms of every way I perceived everything. And moved to Vancouver in 2004. Like I said, I came here and got more involved that way. So, yeah.
It seems like Marc has been more than single issue, you know, with the obscenity, the fight for free speech before the marijuana centric or just, you know, kind of everything. Mm-hmm. Are you single issue? I mean, I guess it would be hard not to be if your husband's in prison for a single issue, but it's really more than the same. He's really in there for free speech, I'd say. The seeds were just the window dressing. But
the drug ties into absolutely everything, so it can't be called a single issue. I mean, when we talk about legalizing marijuana, it's not just about let's make pot legal to smoke it and get high. It's about so much more. It's about saving billions or trillions of dollars in court and policing costs and prison costs. It's about changing the way that the entire justice system works. We know that the United States has one in every 100 Americans behind bars and a full quarter of the world's prisoners in the United States. We know that the drug war has led to that in huge ways, and the drug war depends on keeping marijuana illegal. Way more people use and grow and consume marijuana than all other drugs, illegal drugs combined, I think it would be fair to say. So it ties into the economy, it ties into justice, it ties into racism and the fact that there are minorities that are kept down by these types of laws. It ties into the war. I'm very anti-war in every sense. I think all this occupation and war overseas and expansion of the military in Canada is so depressing and so wrong. So I'm 100% opposed to war. And anybody on my Twitter feed or on Facebook can see that I'll definitely comment about that a lot. And the war has a lot to do with the drug war as well. They're very closely tied. Every country that's occupied is also a producer of illicit drugs that go up in production rates as they're smuggled back by the very same large convoys that have been sent over there from North America. So you've got this whole setup where, I mean, it's not a surprise to say the CIA smuggled cocaine and all that sort of stuff. I mean, that's all out there.
I mean, people, that was a big thing when it broke how many ever years ago, and it got forgotten so quickly. It was almost like, well, the press has exposed it, so the problem is solved, you know? Well,
the same way with the DEA admitting that they're laundering millions of dollars from Mexican drug cartels. Well, my husband was indicted with money laundering, and he never laundered money, and that he was indicted by the DEA's own involvement, and yet they're laundering millions of dollars for the drug cartels? Come on.
I mean, I feel like everything that most governments do would fall under the statute of RICO, you know, the conspiracy laws in America.
Yeah. And so that when we talk about marijuana legalization, it's impossible to say it's one issue because it's not. I mean, even when you start to go into the oil wars, the fact that a lot of these wars are not, you know, they're tied into resources and oil. Well, hemp is an incredible resource that is being totally ignored and hidden away and underutilized, but it was part of the founding roots of America. It's a huge part of the history of mankind, the use of hemp and the use of cannabis. And so it ties into just even human history and achievement, and also the suppression of great achievement because of the fear of it. There's so much history about cannabis, I can't even begin to get all into it. But the point is, and I'm not a one-issue person because I care very much about human rights issues, about the war, about the environment. There's a lot, and it all ties into cannabis in one way or another, too.
Here in America, it seems like there's a false divide of left to right. I mean, conservatives piss me off in a certain way, and liberals piss me off in a certain way. I mean, Obama was supposed to be the alternative to these square, old, gray-haired, white, Bible-thumping guys that want to take away everything, you know, take away dirty magazines or something. And Obama, he campaigned on decriminalizing marijuana, then was asked about it in a press conference shortly after being elected and laughed at the guy's face and says, I don't think we'll be doing that. And he was supposed, you know, he campaigned on being anti-war, the opposite of Bush, and he's killing more people per month than Bush did. It's kind of blowing my mind.
Yeah, he's continuing the exact same thing, and that's why Mark and I 100% support Ron Paul for president. Absolutely.
Yay.
We can't quite say that old white-haired men, especially Republicans from Texas, I mean, no, people are a little scared of that, but really, Ron Paul is the only chance to save America, and it is so disappointing to me that people can't get past their party politics and realize that you've got to judge an individual by their own accomplishments, not by what party they're with or what their left or right places might be.
So yeah, When I registered Republican, I registered Republican so I could vote for him. And almost like 99% of my old friends in San Francisco from when I used to live there, like, disowned me. Like, oh, you're a Republican. And they don't realize that old gray-haired white guy is not like Newt Gingrich. You know, I heard someone say, Ron Paul is the squarest guy in the world, and he fights for your right to not be square at all.
Yeah, and it's just really sad that people will even lose friends over this. I mean, the ones who go, oh, Republican, what? I'm not your friend anymore. Well, they're guilty of the ignorance that they're accusing the Republicans of having. I mean, you can't, to be so close-minded is exactly what they claim to hate the Republicans for being unable to think outside the box or, you know, so it's just disappointing. But, you know, Ron Paul's still spreading the message, and there's so many people being brought into that, so it's not a failure.
I do a podcast. This is my side podcast. It's all interviews that that I'm interviewing you for, Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. I do a weekly podcast with a co-host. It's called the Freedom Feens Podcast. And my co-host Nima Vedati and I made a documentary film called Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. Have you seen it?
No, I haven't.
The subtitle of the movie, or the tagline of it, is because there's no such thing as half free. I mean, the basic idea is, in America, you're either left and smoke weed or support weed, or you're right wing and you're a gun guy who hates weed, and the weed people hate the gun people and the gun people hate the weed people. And we tried, and I think succeeded, to show that if you're into one of those rights, you should support the other right, even if you don't do it, because the war on drugs fuels the war on guns, and the war on guns fuels the war on drugs. I mean, look how, like, Eric Holder, you know, tried to use the drug war in Mexico to take away scary black rifles in America, things like that.
Right. Well, that sounds good.
Yep. I'll turn y'all on to it.
You're listening to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast, a tasty stew of freedom and fun. Subscribe at kittyfeet.com. That's kittyfeet.com.
I think I had more questions about prison. I guess because even though I do not break any laws, it's kind of a hobby of mine of, like, I don't break any laws, and I spend 24 hours a day yelling at the government, and I'm trying to see how long I can do that before I get thrown in prison or detained indefinitely for no charges or droned. So I am curious about prison, and I'm kind of joking, but I'm kind of serious. I mean, that's the reality in America. And I'm kind of half kidding, but I'm kind of half serious. I mean, in the past 4 months here, they've passed like 5 sweeping unconstitutional bills that do everything from enable them to detain you indefinitely, to drone you without a trial and call it justice, you know, to drone an American citizen without a trial and call it justice, to,
terrifying. It is, and it's happening so fast and swiftly, so nobody pays attention.
I know.
Mark is in a medium security prison, but he hasn't ever been threatened or in harm's way from the other inmates because they all respect him. They know that he's in there for a, you know, very different reason than most prisoners are. He is there with murderers. He's there with bank robbers, a lot of people like that. But again, these aren't people that are muscling around and trying to beat anyone up, and there isn't any violence that he's witnessed. There may be scuffles or fights between Hispanics and blacks or any sort of racial, because there are divides along those lines, but nobody's going to beat you up for talking to someone of a different race. In Mark's case, again, Mark is a very charismatic and very unique person. He gets along with people. He makes the best of situations, and he changes people's lives all the time whenever he meets them. So he hasn't had an issue in prison in that sense at all. And it's much better to be in a federal facility than a private for-profit facility. Those are mostly reserved for non-citizens and illegal immigrants and drug offenders. So it was a lot worse before when Mark was in Georgia in a Geo group private prison. So now that he's in this facility, it's better. Typically, the low securities have big dormitory style, which is what Mark was in the private prison, which was not very good. You have like 60 different guys on bunk beds in a big room together, and that's your cell. So there's never any privacy or anything. So low security is typically like that, because there's so many Americans being sent to prison for nonviolent offenses that the low securities are gigantic warehouses. Medium security is for others with longer term sentences, bigger levels of drug dealing and that sort of thing. You get a cell with 2 or 3 people. Some cells are triple bunked, and that's not good. But the facilities themselves, they have to meet standards. They all get accredited every year. There's a lot of shoddy work and laziness, but you find that in every industry. And really, most of the guards that work in prisons couldn't get a job anywhere else, because the fastest growing industry is prisons in America, and there's not a whole lot else to do. So many people who are suckered into either doing military work or security or policing work end up just in a prison guarding a bunch of people that aren't a threat to anyone else, all in the name of making money on the stock market for these corporations that work with these governments. And we know that prisons lobby to maintain the drug laws, so they're doing it for their own interests, but that's a big group we're up against.
Are you hopeful for the future?
Generally, yes. I mean, mankind is always going to have ups and downs and struggles, and there's a lot that we have today, which is far better than how things used to be. Just the fact that I'm talking to you over a computer that I can communicate anywhere in the world with anybody with. I'm sure we may be spied on and all that, but just the fact we can do it is incredible still. And, you know, I think there's a lot of awareness coming up with people. I think as things get tougher, people get stronger. I do think things are going to get worse, particularly for Canada. We have a conservative government here that got majority government power, which means opposition parties can't stop them from doing anything. So we basically have friendly fascism government, except our government isn't even friendly because nobody cracks a smile. But they're all powerful. They can do whatever they like. And they've just introduced mandatory minimums for drug offenses here in Canada, along with a slew of other laws, similar to what's going on in the U.S., you know, with copyright laws and spying laws and terrorism laws. Actually, we're kind of the same country now because our borders have been integrated. We had that Beyond the Border Security Pact. And recently, the Mexican and Canadian and U.S. governments just agreed to ramp up the military use and intelligence sharing for the war on drugs. So we're in for the ride with you guys. So that means things are going to get a lot worse at the federal level. But I think in terms of municipal government, provincial or state government, counties and all that, there's a lot of change happening from the ground level up. And that's kind of how it needs to happen. And a lot of pressure has to be put on the top by the legs that hold it up. So we have a lot of progress on the horizon. There's a lot of inspiring things going on in the United States and Canada, but there's also a lot of bad too. So it depends how you look at it. You know, if you look at the positive parts, then everything's groovy. And if you look at the negative, then we're all going to hell. But I try to keep a little positive each day so I don't get sucked in by all the bad.
Do you know about a computer telephony program sort of like Skype called Mumble?
Nope.
Mumble is higher audio quality than Skype, and it's encrypted and secure. It's something that I've been trying to turn all activists onto. You know, partly
I don't use Skype except to do interviews like this once in a while, so it's useless to me otherwise. And I figure I'm being spied on all the time anyway. My husband was called the most wanted drug trafficker kingpin in Canada.
For those six seeds.
So you know, I've given up all notions of privacy, really.
Is he, the fact that he's blogging from jail and doing, or from prison and doing activism, is that work against him? I mean, do they look at that as not good behavior or anything like that?
He did get in trouble for blogging about Geo Group's private for-profit prison, and that's why he got shipped out of there all by himself on a Geo Group bus and put in a much better facility. So really, they've just kind of the U.S. is starting to realize what Canada has had to realize over Mark's many years and decades of activism, is that you can't shut the man up. Just give him what he wants, and or don't give him what he wants in the case of when he tried to get arrested for selling books and magazines about pot when that was illegal. They had already seen him do that so many times before. They were like, nope, don't bother. Don't go arrest him. He'll just get all the attention he wants. And, you know, so in this terms of prison, they put Mark somewhere that had everything he complained about not having that prison should have. So they kind of gave him everything he needed to shut him up, and he hasn't really been able to complain about much, and he doesn't really want to complain. Mark's not a complainer. He likes to bring attention to injustices and wrongdoings, but he's never complaining about, oh, poor me, I'm so important, and I shouldn't be here. It's never about that. People will see that he never complains. He's very much doing the time and trying to make the most of it.
That was an interesting set of unintended consequences of him complaining and getting a better situation. Do you think that it's possible in any way that they want him talking and being active because it fuels their war in any way?
I think they realize that if they try and stop him, he brings more attention to it. He got nationwide, like every time something happened to him down there, when he got infected with MRSA, the superbug, everything really bad that happened, the national news all across Canada was talking about it. And Geo Group, which is trying to open prisons here and meeting with our government now, didn't really like that. Neither did the Bureau of Prisons or the Department of Justice. And so they rejected Mark's transfer application to come back to Canada on the basis of being too complainy, I suppose. You can find all the info about that easily on freemark.ca, too, about the transfer rejection by the U.S. government. But I think they realized that if you try and cause him trouble, you'll get more trouble in return than it's worth. So, but I don't know. I don't want to take it for granted that he's in a good place right now. It could always be a lot worse. So who knows?
You're listening to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. That proves you're smarter than most people.
Is there medical marijuana in Canada?
Yes, there is. It's run by the federal government, Health Canada. It's called the Medical Marijuana Access Regulations. And we have quite a few thousand Canadians who have their license to grow and or to possess a medical marijuana. The only options really for patients is to either grow it themselves. And technically, they're only supposed to use seeds from Health Canada, which are worthless. So they're either supposed to grow it themselves or designate someone to grow it for them or get their marijuana from Health Canada, which operates a mine or a place where they grow their own, which is garbage. Again, nobody uses that because it's just absolute trash. Kind of like how the federal government of the United States grows their own marijuana in Mississippi, coincidentally and ironically. But they grow their own for just like four or five patients who are still alive in a program where they send them medical marijuana. So the Canadian government has that going on here with thousands of patients. But there's a lot of problems with the program. There's a lot of unconstitutional type things with it. There's been countless court cases. I can't even keep up with it anymore. So as it stands right now, patients can, it's very difficult actually to get a license though. Doctors are very, very hesitant to sign paperwork. It's huge piles of paperwork. They aren't being told anything about it. In fact, they're being told not to sign paperwork. So you end up getting a few doctors who agree to, but then they get kind of shunned from the medical community for agreeing to do that. So there's still not easy access. But for those who do have a license, they can grow it. They're given a plant limit. And they are doing that. But our federal government is trying to phase out growing rights so that patients will only be allowed to buy their marijuana from companies contracted out by Health Canada. Which, of course, everybody here is fighting against because it's not fair to take away people's right to garden their own medicine. It's healthy in many, many ways to garden and to know what you're consuming. So there's still a lot of changes ahead, and it's a slow, burdening, it's bureaucracy, it's government. And in that sense, it's doing harm. So they're trying to change it, a lot of the medical marijuana activists. And in fact, there's going to be a big decision released tomorrow in Victoria, our provincial capital here. And there's also another case in Ontario, this province of Ontario, related to it too. So lots happening there. But yes, we do have medical marijuana and we do have dispensaries, but they operate in a gray zone. They're technically not legal. They're not authorized under the government, but they provide a service that the courts have repeatedly said is needed because access isn't readily available otherwise. So we'll see what happens. Lots of exciting, interesting times ahead.
So it's heavily regulated, but it's the same from province to province?
Yeah, it's a federal program. The provinces don't have any say or anything. In fact, you know, you guys have states' rights, which we don't really have up here, but each but provinces do get to manage their own health and I think education, so they get to budget for all that themselves. So there's some people who are going to try arguing that because medical marijuana is an issue of health, that the province should be able to regulate distribution and all that. So we'll see where that goes.
Yeah, laws for everything vary widely in America. I mean, I'm in Wyoming, which does not have medical marijuana. I'm sandwiched between Colorado and Montana, which do. And, you know, in Wyoming, you could have a gun in your pocket with no permit legally, and it has not increased crime at all since they put that in. You know, if you have an ounce of pot, you're going to go to prison for a year. Whereas in California, if you have a gun outside the house anywhere and you cannot get a permit for it, you're going to go to prison for a year, but pot is practically legal. Do you have a lot of variation between provinces like that there in laws?
Yeah, there's differences in drinking age and driving license age and stuff. So yeah, there's differences.
Is there any push by the federal government there to get rid of that and unify things more?
Not so much, because they still claim to be conservative and pretend to be
small government.
Ha ha!
They're the biggest government we've had in Canada, and I won't even go into all that. But anyway, but no, there isn't a real push for that.
Have you ever had problems traveling or crossing borders, state or national, because of your activism?
Not really. I've been questioned about what I'm doing going down to the U.S. all the time. And, of course, it's on record, and they have all the notes and everything. They're always typing away in their computer, so they know I'm going down to visit Mark. And I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm not operating a seed business. I'm legit as they come, so I shouldn't have any problems, and let's hope I don't.
Can I ask how old you are, and when did you, what age did you stop being statist and move towards liberty?
I'm 27. I don't mind answering that at all. When did I, well, you know, I just...
Was it gradual or sudden?
I guess gradual. I don't like labeling myself in any way whatsoever, because I'm always open to having my mind changed. But I will say that in 2006, Mark, that is the year we were married, but Mark worked on a cannabis culture special. The issue had a big voting guide where he analyzed the voting records of every member of Congress on 10 different key things related to cannabis, and at that time related to, you know, the Patriot Act and that sort of thing, the School of Americas and such. So he analyzed all their voting records, and number one was Ron Paul. And that's when I first got introduced to Ron Paul, and I fell in love with him. I just couldn't believe that he was speaking such truth. And I've, you know, I read Atlas Shrugged and The Fountainhead, which I read just because Mark read them, and I found them very interesting as books, but I also found 1984 and Animal Farm and other books interesting too. So I'm not an Ayn Randian. I haven't read anything about her philosophies, and I can't really call myself a libertarian, because I do believe government does have a role to play. I don't know how much, though. I don't know what they should cover or not. So I'm still learning. I'm still young. I will plead ignorance on many different political issues. So, you know, but I believe first and foremost in liberty of the individual, that the individual should never be harmed by the state, and that the state should never cause harm to harmless people. And that's why the drug war, I fight against that, because it's definitely harm against harmless people. And I support Ron Paul for president, because I believe he would end the wars and do a lot for individual liberty. So that for me is very, very important. And I'm definitely not or a socialist of any kind. I do believe in some health programs and stuff. But
I'll make a prediction right now. I'll make a prediction, and it's a very positive prediction. You'll be an anarchist by age 30.
Well, you know, Mark called himself kind of an anarchist capitalist of sorts, and we have other friends, another friend who calls himself an anarchist, and, you know, well, I know it's not just dressing up in black and wearing a mask, that's for sure.
Oh, and it's not violent, too. It's not violent. And you're on the right, interview here, because this is an anarcho-capitalist podcast. I just find that the longer... I have great respect for political activism, but I have stopped doing it. My activism now is talking and educating, because I really have gotten to the point of belief that politics
is all bought out and impossible.
It is. And you know,
soul-crushing. It really is.
The one politician that'll let a cancer patient smoke a joint is also the politician that's going to screw you in 20 other ways. So, you know, I heard this saying I really like, is that All elections are advance auctions of stolen goods. And another saying is, all politicians steal all your money and rights and then dole them out in tiny bits to buy your vote.
Yeah, fair to say.
Well, I really have great respect for what you two are doing, and I'm going to link all your stuff and promote this as much as I can and try to get the word out. And I really appreciate you taking time to do this. Thank you, Jodie.
Hey, thanks for having me, Michael.
Yep, absolutely.
Awesome. Okay, have a good night.
Worms.
Are you one of the 12% of Americans who still approves of our government? Then we need your help to force the other 88% into compliance. When you're not busy spying on your neighbors or squinting at everyone, tell anyone who will listen why more government is a good thing. you'll get a warm and fuzzy feeling demanding more taxes and arguing in favor of gun control while militarizing our police, because folks just aren't smart enough to handle real freedom.
That is so square. Check out the additional Freedom Fiend show, Freedom Fiends Live, every Sunday on the LRN.FM streaming feed or satellite radio.
Broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker inside a mountain near an undisclosed location in the rural Wild West of the occupied states of America.
Freedom Fiends Live expands on the Fiends' weekly Wednesday podcasts, but now we're kicking the hornet's nest live. Talk back to the back talkers every Sunday from 5 to 7 p.m. East Coast time. From the makers of Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom, Freedom Fiends Live. Call in soon before we get droned.
Thank you for listening to the Anarchy Gumbo Podcast. Subscribe at kittyfeet.com. That's kittyfeet.com. All with a rotating guest on a spit, barbecued for your pleasure.
Outtakes, yay.